Good evening. I'm Bill LaForge, and I'm president of Delta State, and I'm pleased to welcome you to the second season of the Delta State University Colloquia. This is our Distinguished Speaker Lecture Series, and we're especially pleased to welcome tonight our students, our faculty, staff, and alumni, former faculty and staff, as well as members of the community and members of the professions from throughout the Delta. For our inaugural lecture for this academic year, we're very excited to have a man who has given years of distinguished service to our nation and who possesses an amazing grasp of the U.S. economy and its relationship to our government. Charles Bowsher has enjoyed a distinguished career in government and in the private sector. In 1996, he completed 15 years of office as Comptroller General of the United States and head of the General Accounting Office, GAO, now known as the Government Accountability Office. His appointment as Comptroller General by President Ronald Reagan in 1981 capped a background of experience in both government and corporate endeavors. A very unique position in our federal government, the Comptroller General position is appointed by the President and confirmed by the Senate and serves a term of 15 years, the longest in our government of this sort of appointment. The agency headed by the Comptroller General, the GAO, is actually a legislative services organization under the auspices of Congress, our legislative branch. The Government Accountability Office itself is an independent agency that provides to the United States Congress audit, investigative, and evaluatory services dealing with all federal programs and spending. Now, if you haven't heard of it, you're not alone. It is not in the limelight and is not usually featured in anything but congressional testimony, and it's cited sometimes in literature and as an author of a report. But the general public really hears very little and sees very little about this unique agency. But it's huge, 3,000 or 4,000 employees. And each agency employee has a very important role to play in our government. The agency does play a key role in our government by providing fair, independent, and nonpartisan research and evaluation. And it's sometimes referred to as the watchdog of the Treasury. Prior to serving as Comptroller General, Mr. Bowsher, who is a certified public accountant, was associated with Arthur Anderson and Company for 25 years, except for 4 years when he served as Assistant Secretary of the Navy for Financial Management. There, he earned distinguished public service awards from both the Navy Department and the Department of Defense. He has served on numerous corporate boards throughout his career, including American Express Bank, National Steel Company, Newport News Shipbuilding, and DeVry, Inc. He serves on advisory boards, including Washington Mutual Investors Fund. He was appointed as a public member of the board of the National Association of Securities Dealers, which oversees the NASDAQ system and the over-the-counter securities markets. From 1997 to 2001, he was chairman of the Public Oversight Board, an independent private sector body that monitors and reports on the self-regulatory programs and the activities of the SEC practice of the Division of CPA Firms of the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants. He is a trustee for the Center for Naval Analysis, the United States Navy Memorial Foundation, the Concord Coalition, and the Hitachi Foundation, and he serves on the advisory boards at several universities around the country. He has been a trustee of the Logistics Management Institute, and he's also, believe it or not, in his 80s, the newly elected president of the Metropolitan Club of Washington, D.C., where he has treated me to many wonderful breakfasts and visits over the years. Born in Elkhart, Indiana, Mr. Bowsher graduated from the University of Illinois in accounting and received an MBA from the University of Chicago after serving 2 years in the United States Army. He is the recipient of honorary doctorates and various honors from 9 universities. He and his wife, Mary, have 2 grown children, and they reside in suburban Maryland, just outside of Washington, D.C. Tonight, we will employ a little different format from that of last year's programs. Following Mr. Bowsher's remarks, we will engage him in a discussion with a panel of 2 students and a professor, whom I will introduce later, and Mr. Bowsher will also entertain questions from the audience. At the conclusion of the program, we invite you to join us for a reception in his honor in the foyer. Charles Bowsher is one of those incredible people who knows a lot about a lot of different and important issues in our country today. In Washington circles, he is often, as many in his kind are often referred to, as a policy wonk. Now, that phrase, despite its sound, is actually a compliment. It means he's really smart and he really knows his stuff. Despite his vast knowledge and experience, you will find that he is a very modest and often understated leader. He confounds political circles because of his fair and honest brokerage of issues, so fair that he is highly complimented by the fact that no one has ever been able to figure out if he is a Republican or a Democrat. He served in the administrations of President Johnson, a Democrat, and President Nixon, a Republican, so his bipartisan roots run deep. He's actually a registered independent in the state of Maryland. His experience with the federal government, especially with respect to the U.S. economy, is a veritable treasure trove for the ages, and we are fortunate to be able to host him at Delta State. He has been a trusted leader and advisor, a go-to professional on matters of government policy and the economy for more than five decades, and he has been a mentor and inspiration for me as well along the way, especially in the writing of my book, Testifying Before Congress, a feat that he undertook more than 200 times. Ladies and gentlemen, for a look at the state of the nation's finances from a true insider, please help me welcome the Honorable Charles Bowsher.
Yeah. Well, thanks very much, Bill. That was a very generous introduction, and I'll tell you a little story that one time I got another one up in New York City, and when the guy that was introducing me got to the 15-year term, he stopped, he looked at me, and he said, "Mr. Bowsher, I want you to know you wouldn't even get 15 years in New York if you committed manslaughter." But it is the longest term, and it gives you independence, and it gives you the opportunity to work on all the important programs and the issues facing the country. And so I was very fortunate to have the job. On the financial condition of our country, it's really interesting when you think about it. I had a lot of visitors from overseas. We actually had an international organization of auditors generals, which is what they're generally called in other countries, of 150 countries. And we met every 3 years, but a lot of the auditor generals came through Washington, and they wanted to generally study how we did it. But they always started off, I think, thinking that this is America, this is the most powerful country in the world, the richest country in the world. And I would try to remind them that that wasn't always true. In fact, one time I got a request from China. This would be in their mid-80s, where they wanted to send a delegation over because they were just starting up an audit function. And they all showed up in their Mao suits and everything like that. We had to get all our interpreters and everything like that. But I always tried to explain to them that, you know, you go back to 1900, the turn of the 20th century, and most of Europe still looked upon this country as a maybe an advanced developing country, but certainly not in the ranks of the major European countries. In fact, there's a beautiful hotel in Frankfurt, Germany that has engraved all the important capitals of the world in their building, and there's no name of any United States city there. And I think that tells a lot. But when we got going in the 20th century, we moved right along. When we got dragged into World War I at the end because the Germans kept sinking our ships, one of the Australian ambassadors who came to lunch with one day said, you know, not only did America bring fresh troops to the war in Europe in 1917, but they brought their treasury. And he said, by this time, all of Europe was broke because they had got themselves into a terrible war in 1914, which is the anniversary this year, 100 years, when they stumbled into that terrible situation. And wars are very expensive. And therefore, they really got themselves into a bad financial situation as well as a war situation. And most people don't focus so much on the financial costs of wars and what it does to a country. And I think if you look at the 20th century, you'll see that America really did quite well financially because we were the arsenal of democracy and we didn't get into those wars right away. And we had built up our great industry, and when we came out in 1945, we had spent $296 billion on World War II, but we had sold $185 billion of war bonds. And every one of us, I was just a young boy at the time, but I remember with my quarter every year, every week going to school and buying my stamp. And then when you got $18.75 worth of stamps, you got your war bond. And everybody was involved in the financial underpinning, you might say, of America being successful in that war. And then, of course, we came out of the war where our debt was 100% in relation to our GNP, which is really a lot. And, of course, people were worried about that. Now, we never really paid that debt off, but we built the country's economy, and it became gradually smaller and smaller. Also, when we went into the Korean War, Harry Truman asked for a surtax, and we put that surtax on, and it paid for most of that effort. And then we came along with the Vietnam War, and President Johnson was reluctant to do that. But finally, he had a $25 billion deficit, and he was finally convinced that he should do a surcharge, and we turned that around to a $3 billion surplus in 1 year. And so by the time that in the mid-70s, we were really in very good financial shape as a country, both in our private sector and in our government. We were in somewhat of a minor recession, though. The managing partner of Arthur Anderson came home from Europe and said, Chuck, he said, what would you think of doing a balance sheet for the federal government? And I've been talking to people in Europe, and they'd like to just understand the United States' financial situation better. And I said, well, you know, most people in the government probably don't think they need a balance sheet, I said. But he insisted we do it, so we did it. They gave me 12 people. We worked all summer, and we produced it. And we only had $465 billion of debt at the end of fiscal 74. Which was really a kind of a small percentage of our GNP at that point and that. So we were in good shape, in other words. But we pointed out that some of the liabilities were not shown fully, like the pension costs and things like that. And so it was a good effort. And then, much to our surprise, New York City ran into a major fiscal crisis later that year. And I don't know whether you remember or not, but they tried to get to handle it by the state, the governor supporting them, but there just wasn't enough money, and there was a lot of opposition from the upstate Republicans, and so eventually they had to turn to the federal government. And when they turned to the federal government, President Ford got a lot of people saying, well, you don't have to bail them out, they can figure it out themselves, but eventually they really couldn't. And so finally, President Ford did agree to a $3.5 billion loan program. And at the last minute, the Congress wrote in a sentence into the legislation that said the Secretary of Treasury, Bill Simon, would have to certify that New York City could repay that loan every time he gave them a chunk of the loan. It was a $3.2 billion total loan, and they were thinking of giving it to them in about $250 million at a time. He quickly called in three of the big accounting firms and asked us if we could be his eyes and ears up there. And We just showed up with our little balance sheet of the federal government, and that so intrigued him that why he gave us a job. And so I went up there with 40 people trying to sort out New York in 2 weeks, the last 2 weeks of December. And we finally got the report down to him on New Year's Eve. And I took a vote of the 40 people that was working for me. I said, you know more about New York City than any other people, including the New Yorkers here. Do you think they'll be able to repay? And not a hand went up. And I said, do you think they'll be able to produce the financial statements to the Treasury Department that we've requested? And not a hand went up. And they were all proven wrong. Because Governor Kerry, who had been a congressman, knew how Washington worked, held a meeting once a month. He had all the important people there. He had the bankers, the unions, the developers, everybody that had contributed to every major power, you might say, in New York City, but many who had contributed to this financial crisis. And what you really had in New York City at that time in the municipal bond market was that every third municipal bond that was sold had New York in the description, because Governor Rockefeller had also done what Bob Moses had done with all the tri-borough and other authorities. Instead of getting money through the taxing of the state and things like that, they went to Wall Street and sold bonds. And finally, the Wall Street people got nervous and decided that they wouldn't show up to buy the bonds 1 week. And of course, that precipitated the panic, and that's why we had to have the federal loan. I just tell this story because a lot of people think that governments have unlimited borrowing authority, and in some respects they do legally, but when people don't show up to buy your bonds, why, you can have some problems, as we did there. But we worked it out, and then I was invited down to speak to a group called the State Controllers, Treasurers, Budget People, Heads, in Charleston, South Carolina. And they met me at the airport, and they said, we're very pleased you agreed to come down and talk. We really don't want you to indicate for a moment that we have any of the same problems that New York City has. And I said, oh, okay. So then I gave my talk. I didn't infer that they did, but you know, after they listened to it, they readily saw that most of them did have some of those similar problems. So some of the states started having annual audits and started doing like that. And then later when I became Comptroller General, working with Senator John Glenn, of the chairman of the government office, we actually got a bill passed in Congress which required all the states and all the large cities that had taken large federal grants in that to have an annual audit and to and make it public and like that. So we made real progress in the state and local government. In the meantime, we were still in good shape because even after the Vietnam War, all the recessions that we've had, the Depression, World War II, when President Reagan came in, we were had less than $1 trillion of debt at the federal level. And then unfortunately, President Reagan got sold this idea on supply side economics. Cut taxes, go strong on defense, but you can pay for the defense because the economy will boom so well that the revenue will be great and everything will be worked out. Well, he also at the same time, first during the campaign, Bush, who was running against him, later to be his vice president, said this was voodoo economics. And Jim Baker, his very close associate, I said that they couldn't figure out how you could do both, cut the taxes and go big in the defense, because defense is very costly. Wars are very costly. And so anyway, in his first year towards the end, he put me in as the Comptroller General, and I watched how each year all of a sudden we were adding to the debt, and we were having these larger deficits. And so I'd go over to the Secretary of Treasury's office, and I'd lay that out to him and say, we got to be careful here. This is not working as everybody thought that might and that. But it was working very well as far as the public was quite pleased with lower taxes. And so then we came to the second 4 years, and that's when Baker left the chief of staff job and went over to be Secretary of Treasury, and Dick Darman became OMB director, and I met with them again, and they agreed with me, but they were working on the tax bill then and things like that. But to make a long story short, why they, as they came to, got elected to be president themselves, Bush, and that, and as he was coming to the end of his first 4 years, he realized that the debt now was $4.5 trillion, up from less than a trillion. And so he wanted to do something, and he did. He put it through a tax increase, but a lot of people didn't forgive him for that because he had used that famous speech at getting the nomination, read my lips, and like that. But I also think it was unfortunate he didn't get reelected because I think he really did the right thing at that point. But anyway, eventually the Clintons put in more tax increases and also put in PAYGO, which was a technique of where you cut the budget somewhere else if you're going to increase over here. And that worked. And so by the time the Clintons went out of office, why, we were down to, we were actually at a balanced budget, the first time since the Eisenhower administration. And so I think we were in really good shape going forward at that point. And then what happened, of course, is when Cheney and Bush came in, much to our surprise, they cut the taxes right away. Paul O'Neill, the Secretary of Treasury, did not want to do that. He had been on a board that I was on, and he came over and had dinner with me one night at the Metropolitan Club and said that he thought this was a big mistake. Well, then, of course, the cutting the taxes got compounded by the going to war in Iraq and going to these wars, and these wars really cost a lot. One of the things I had to do with the first Iraq war, the Pentagon wasn't willing to make an estimate of how much the war was going to cost. When Leon Panetta was the chairman of the budget committee, and he asked if I could do it, and I said I could if they'd give me the basic numbers over at the Pentagon, because I did it for the last couple of years at the Vietnam War when I was at the Pentagon. And so I figured it was $40 billion to just assemble the troops before hostilities even started. So that gives you a magnitude of how costly modern war really is in that. So. And then in that case, Jim Baker and everybody went around the world and raised it with other countries because he said, look, at what we're really protecting is your supply of oil, and everybody should contribute, not just the American taxpayer. So so anyway, 2 years later, I was in Japan, and I was having tea with the Auditor General of Japan, and he said, Mr. Bowsher, would you be willing to meet with some of my staff? They'd like to ask you a few questions and that. I said, sure, I'd be happy to do that. And I ended up in a room looked like this. 200 of his staff was there. And they asked me a lot of questions, but one finally asked the question, did the United States make any money on that $40 billion thing? And I said, we might have made a little, but you got to give us credit. We spent billions and billions developing our great Navy and our Air Force and our Army. So we were the ones that were able to go into action. So you really got a bargain on it. And so later on, some of those young guys said they were glad and kind of impressed that I was willing to answer it candidly. They were all taking bets that I wouldn't want to answer that question. And I said, but we truly spent that $40 billion, or very close to it, I said. But anyway, right now, unfortunately, what the additional thing problem that hit us was, of course, the great banking crisis here in 2008 and 09. And so when Bush went out of office, we had $1.5 trillion deficit. And so you add up these $1 trillion deficits as we've been running. Now we're down to 500 or half a trillion. But we're up to, in 2 years, we'll be at $21 trillion of debt for the federal government. That's $20 trillion more than when Ronald Reagan came into office. And right now, we are able to sell the bonds to finance that debt. What does that take? Well, that takes selling $8 trillion of bonds the last few years, each year, because you have to sell $7 trillion for refinancing all the bonds that came due that year. A lot of the federal financing is short term. And then you got to then one more trillion for the new debt or the new deficit. So that that is a very dangerous thing because in addition to us, the federal government selling that debt, you have agency debt, which is the Fannie, the Freddie, the Ginnie Mae, the Federal Home Loan Bank. And so we really are selling more bonds every year than the GNP of any other country besides the United States. And that means a lot of people have to show up to buy those bonds. And I had Mary Miller, the Undersecretary of Treasury, over recently at the Metropolitan Club to describe how we sell those bonds today. We had 222 auctions. They used to have maybe an auction a month years back. Now we do 222, and all the big banks have to show up, and the big insurance company, and the sovereign funds of the Middle East, and the China, and everything like that. And so now we end up with 50% of our $20 trillion being owed to outsiders, people out of our country. And we're up to 100%. Now we're back to the same percentage at the end of World War II that we have. But at the end of World War II, it practically was all owed to Americans. In other words, we all owned our little war bonds and everything like that. So you don't have outside pressures. Now, what kind of an outside pressure could we have? Well, let me give you an illustration. And that is in 08, if you remember, Secretary Paulson was trying to get a $700 billion package through Congress to save the big banks. And he was having trouble. In fact, they turned him down. And then they went back and the stock market crashed for two straight days. And they all rushed back and gave him a $700 billion. What they did shortly thereafter was they were not getting the people to show up to buy the agency debt. And so then Paulson, the secretary, comes out and says, I want you to know that we have the government will be behind agency debt, Ginnie Mae, Freddie Mac, and all that, 100%. And I remember being with Paul Volcker that day when that was announced, and I'd worked a lot with Paul when he was chairman of the Fed. And he said, you know, I used to go around Europe and places like that in Tokyo and tell all the big bankers, you've got to recognize that our agency debt does not have the full faith and credit of the federal government behind it, just the Treasury debt. And he said, when I get done making that statement, they'd kind of smile and laugh at me and say, yeah, but you'll never be able to let it go down. And of course, he says, this just proves it, when Paulson had the gun. Then he also was getting some criticism from some of the conservative people about why did he do that. So he came out and he made a speech that said, don't worry, we're going to stand behind it, but we don't have to put any money in it because everybody knows we're standing behind it and nobody will call us on it. Well, one call he got was from the Minister of Finance in China. And he said, let me get this straight. You're not going to buy any of this agency debt, but you want me to continue to buy it. And so shortly thereafter, the Treasury and the Federal Reserve started buying some agency debt. And that's why you have a lot of debt now sitting over on the balance sheet of the Federal Reserve. So my point is here, and that is we're getting ourselves into a dangerous situation because right now the rest of the world is in such turmoil that the safety of the American economy, government, and the strength of our financial markets, people are willing to buy our bonds at very low interest rate. But when you get up to $20 trillion, if you think about it, why, you then have a situation that we're right now, we're paying $250 billion in interest costs because, as I say, a lot of it is short-term debt. But if you get up to where it's 3%, that's and it was all at 3%, average 3%, that would be $600 billion interest. At 4%, $800 billion, and at 5%, a trillion. Which means that our trillion-dollar interest cost would be the same as our defense and national security there, and it's the same as our Social Security, same as our health care and costs, and pretty soon we're just going to be running bigger and bigger deficits and everything like that. So the bottom line is here, this is, we can fix, I always claim we can fix any time we get out of kilter on our financial thing, just like we did in New York City. But as Mary Miller pointed out, she is just as dependent on all those big banks and all those sovereign funds showing up to buy those bonds as New York City was in the 70s. So I do believe that, I don't know whether coming out of this election, I'm not too hopeful, but out of the 2016, I hope we get ourselves to the point that both sides, Republicans and Democrats, can come together and get us into a balanced budget situation and not continue to build this debt as we have been. Because I truly believe, I pointed out in a talk I gave to the World Bank just earlier this week, that Japan has 200% of their debt now. They've issued so much debt, but it's all held by the Japanese. So they don't have those outside forces. There was a very senior Japanese person there and said, well, don't give us too much credit, he said, because Mr. Bowsher, think about it. The Japanese people are turning over their savings to the government, getting no interest in income, and they're going to get unruly someday, he says, I think, to finally force people to get their government more into things like that. So anyway, I think it's something that we can deal with, but you got to do just what Governor Kerry did there in New York. You got to bring everybody to the table, and you got to get everybody working together. And that's where I think we stand today on the financial condition. Now, you go over to the private sector, we've done very well. In other words, there was a gentleman who wrote a book on the crash of 29-32, where all our financial institutions went down, and we went into the Great Depression, and that went on a worldwide basis. And he pointed out that the central banks didn't do anything to save it, and the federal governments didn't do anything. Nobody had deposit insurance. And so he said this time, he won the Pulitzer Prize for this book, by the way. He was speaking to us in 09, and so I asked him the question at the end, how do you judge what we did this time? And he said, well, I give him very poor marks leading up to it, but he said, I give him great marks for saving the system. And I think that what they did, they had to do to save the system. In other words, if your banking system goes out of business, it's like losing the blood out of your human system. That's the thing you absolutely have to have to keep the thing. Most people don't realize, Alan Greenspan and Volcker Wolf would come over occasionally at GO and have lunch with me. And I'd say to Alan especially, what do you worry about at night the most? And he'd say the clearing systems. He said, most people don't realize we clear $1 trillion a day. And those clearing systems have to work. And it takes all the major countries to make sure they do work. So all this great economy and the government we have has given America a great economy, a great place in the world, but we've got to make sure we don't abuse it and take advantage of it, and we got to get our financial house in order is kind of my final business line. Thank you. Yeah.
We're going to take our places over here. If you'll sit in this chair right here. Thank you, Mr. Bowsher. Now, the next part, the second chair right here, any of them, actually. We're going to now have a Face the Nation type activity, and so everybody can be very informal and casual. I'm going to ask our three panelists to join me here. Professor Clint Wood from Delta State serves as the chair of our Division of Accountancy, Computer Information, and systems and finance, and he's a member of the Colloquia Series Committee. Kristen Swarek is a student who is works with DoubleQuick Corporate Office as an intern, an accounting intern over in Indianola, and she is a senior accounting major from Isola, Mississippi. Mikkel Sykes, our third participant, is president of the student body here at Delta State. He He's a junior social science education major from Winona, Mississippi. So the format is we're going to have each panelist ask a couple of questions of Mr. Bowsher, then we'll turn it out for the audience. We have folks with microphones to allow you to ask a question of your choice, then we'll come back to the panel and we'll go till we run out of time. We won't go too long. So we'll ask Kristen to ask the first question, please. That's right.
You guys hear me? Okay, I think I'm on now. Very much enjoyed your speech. My first question, can you shed some light on that?
Yeah.
I'm sure you can.
Yeah, sure. I have a mic here. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, the Social Security Trust Fund is a trust fund. It doesn't operate like an insurance company, though, because it is more like a pay-as-you-go. In other words, the workers today are paying really for the pensions of the people who are on Social Security. And it's been a very successful system. The retired people today live so much better than before Social Security. Let me tell you, I'm old enough to know that most of our grandmothers had to live with their sons and daughters. They just didn't have much income prior to Social Security and that. So it's been a great system. And every other industrial country has a national insurance program for their elderly. Yeah. But the one thing that has happened is that they've been running surpluses. Like in 1992, one of the things I explained to Jim Baker and Darman and that over at Treasury was that our deficit was $290 billion official, but it was really $400 billion in operations, and it was $110 surplus from the Social Security. So that means the working people in 1992 were paying in more money than was going out, see. And that had been set by that commission there in during the Nixon administration. And that. But now, as we're getting more older people and a few things like that, we're just hitting the point. But they've got $2 trillion IOU at Treasury that is owed to the Social Security people. So the big thing is, how do you finance it? Well, they're selling more bonds. That's not, yeah. Anybody that's been in business here would know at some point you're financing certain bonds with new bonds is not generally the way you get healthy. And but anyway, we could really change that very easily by making sure that the richer people are paying just the regular rate. In other words, there was always the idea when Roosevelt agreed to put it in, and he was a little reluctant. He was worried about whether the money would always be there. And that is, but the big thing was that all the working class would pay a certain rate, and then over a certain amount, you didn't have to pay any more. And what happened was when they did that last commission, they reduced how much, what the level was, and so now, it's up around 100,000, but it probably should be around 160,000, 170,000. And that means that anybody that's making 170,000 would be paying the same rate on the 170,000 that the person who's making 90,000 is paying on his 90,000. And that's why you'll see sometimes Warren Buffett say that percentage-wise, he's paying less on his income, multi-billion dollars, than his secretary. And there's something wrong with that. And a lot goes back to the fact that on the Social Security, because the secretary is paying that percent on all her income, see. So, but this is very fixable. Now, a lot of people keep looking at the liability, and I was the one that put the liability on the balance sheet. And so I think it's a good warning signal. But it's nothing that anybody should think that we can't afford to do. And it really means is the more successful people should be just paying up to a certain level that would keep it solvent. That's all. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, it's mic up. Yeah, it's mic
on. There you go.
All right. So, like you said, in around 2 years, the national deficit will be around $21 trillion.
Yeah.
So, if you were tasked with balancing the budget, what would be some of the first steps that you take in order to accomplish that?
Well, I think we have not paid for any of the costs of this war on terror. It's the first time we ever went into a major war effort. And a lot of people think, oh, it isn't really a major war. It isn't like World War II. It isn't like Vietnam, right? Well, that's wrong, because we've spent as much now, and Time magazine the other day just said we spent $6 trillion on the war on terror, but my figures are closer to 4 or 5, but that's in current dollars what we spent on World War II. And so you can't go into a major war and want to be the policeman for the world without paying for it. And that's what we've done ever since we invaded Iraq. And so as one step, you got to say to the American people, we're going to have a surcharge, just like we had in Vietnam and the Korean War and everything like that, if you want us to continue to have this big effort around the world with, and of course now it's very touchy because of what's happening in the Middle East. But if we have to do it, we should be paying for it. And we can afford to pay for it. Then the second thing is I would fix that Social Security problem that we discussed about it. And then I think there's lots of areas where you can really cut back on the expense side. And having spent 4 years at the Pentagon, I can tell you there's a lot of areas in the Pentagon and in the military that, in other words, right now we're building what's known as a joint strike fighter. And it means that three services are going to use it. Well, that sounds like it's economical that all three will use it, but they're redesigning it so you end up with three different planes. It's the most costly plane we've ever. In the Vietnam War, we fought it with the F-4 that was $5 million a piece, right? Then we built the F-15 and the F-14, and they were $20 million a piece. This is one airplane, right? Okay, then when we built the B-2 bomber, and Congress cut it back to 20 planes, it really cost $1 billion, and that's more than an aircraft carrier, see? And so the fact that we've got to get control, much more control over our spending on the in the military area. And when you're at war, generally everybody says you have to give the military everything they need, and that's true. But you can't do it decade after decade, because you'll soon. Another thing, too, to give you a good example, when we went to the all-volunteer army, we increased the pay. When I served as a private at the end of the Korean War, I made $75 a month. You wouldn't want to live on $75 a month, huh? But we did. And when my nephew went into the Navy here a couple years ago and he got through boot camp, he was making $22,000 a year. And he got married and he was making over $30,000 with his allotmentcy. And so that's okay if you have a small military that can expand in case of wartime and that. But to have a large thing like making those kind of incomes, and then you give the pensions, you know, a young person that comes into the military at 18, serves 20 years, let's say he's on a nuclear submarine. There's no healthier place than being on a nuclear submarine. You're submerged, there's no bugs in the submarine. At 38, you come out in really good shape. And then you've got a pension for life adjusted for thing. Now, for anybody that's in the war thing, any pension they got, they deserve, you know. But you've got to think more about maybe what we should do is have a system, some people advocate this, of where you would have people come in for 4 years, get a GI Bill, go to college, you know, like that, bring another group in for 4 years. In other words, you wouldn't have this huge tail of pension costs and health care costs for people who are doing 20 years and 30 years. Yeah. So there's lots of major areas in the in the area, and the same in the civilian. Like when I was Comptroller General, the GAO had 5,200 people. And when I went in 81, we didn't have any PCs. They were just coming in. And when I left, everybody had a PC 15 years later. And what we were able to do, and we also had the ability to have a San Francisco team talking to a Washington team via their computer rather than getting on an airplane and ringing in and showing each other's handwritten documents. See, so we cut it down to 3,200. And we produced more reports, more testimonies with the 3,200 than we did with the 5,200. So there's those, but you can't do that in a year. You know, that's one of the problems that sometimes a lot of people come into government and they think, well, you can overnight do it. But, you know, if you get a plan, you can become much more efficient in the government just as well as in the private sector. Yeah.
Professor Woods.
With your years of service at Arthur Anderson, now a public member of the board of the National Association of Security Dealers, which oversees the NASDAQ system and the over-the-counter securities, what do you see as some of the challenges facing today's equity markets?
Well, I think one of the biggest challenges is that they really have lost control of the equity markets. In other words, we used to have the New York Stock Exchange and the NASDAQ, which of course was a computerized thing. And if you look at some other countries like England and Canada, they gradually got rid of the stock exchange, the guys on the floor, and made it into a computerized thing. But they didn't let everybody else create a new. And what you've got now is you've got all the big banks like Goldman Sachs, they have what they call the dark pools. And that means that they're trading in their, only 20% of the equities are traded now on the New York Stock Exchange. And so everybody else is trading, everybody else is, and so if you read Michael Lewis's book, this Flash Trading, he'll give you the real story of why we should all be worried about it's time to get better control over the markets, and the SEC really lost control of those markets. I think that's my biggest worry of the thing. The other big worry is derivatives. In other words, I think derivatives are a wonderful thing if you're just hedging your, if you're a farmer and you want to hedge your corn crop and things like that, so that's what they basically were originally used for. But when you get issuing derivatives like they did in the early 2000 to leverage everybody, and then fund everybody by short-term financing in the repo market, which is another market that hardly anybody understands, what you have is a fragile, and that all collapsed. See, that's why the five biggest broker-dealers had to be saved by the federal government, by Bear Stearns going to J.P. Morgan. Lehman Brothers went out of business and just about brought the whole world economy to a halt. And then you had Merrill Lynch went to Bank of... And the other two, Morgan Stanley, they became banks. That meant they got to the Federal Reserve in the discount window, which meant they had federal bank support there and that. And if the federal government had not stepped in, we could have had just another 1929 crash there in 2008. There's no question. So I do believe that we really need to do a lot of work in making our equity markets safer. Yeah. The equity markets trade well. In other words, when the market's going up, everybody feels what good. But right now, if you read Michael Lewis's book on Flash Trading, you'll get a little nervous about the equity markets, and rightfully so. Yeah.
Kristen?
My next question is, as Comptroller General, you took part in
Yeah.
So my question is, what discrepancies or maybe lack of accounting practices did you discover the most in those audits?
Yeah. Well, first off, John Chafee was the Secretary of the Navy. See, when I went in as Assistant Secretary of the Navy and was like being the CFO of the Navy, that was under the Democrats. I was back on the McNamara team, and then Clark Clifford was Secretary, and then Mel Laird and Dave Packard came in with the Republicans, and John Chafee, the governor from Rhode Island, came in to be Secretary of the Navy, and John Warner was the Undersecretary. And John Chafee said to me one day, he said, one thing that's amazing is the government is so big, we have very little fraud, out-and-out fraud, except when we go overseas, like in Iraq and Afghanistan. We didn't find a lot of problems. Occasionally you'll find a problem, but when you think of the trillions of dollars that we're handling, that's the controls are really quite good and the people are quite honest and everything like that. Where the problem really is in doing keeping an obsolete program going. Let me give you an example, the peanut support program. In the Great Depression, there was a lot of peanut farmers in Georgia and places like that that weren't making it, so they put in a subsidy program, right? Well, today, that program is still there. And most of the families that own those allotments live very nicely in Florida, the grandchildren. And they might make $250,000 from the farmers, that are the peanut farmers, just because they get the money from the guy. In other words, that's an obsolete program. You don't really need to subsidize the peanut farmers like we did in the 30s. But the farm lobby is very strong. And the wheat and the corn and all the sugar people. Oh, well, then you understand this. Yeah. They work together. And so the votes in the Senate are, and I always remember Ronald Reagan, he was going to take this issue on, see. And finally Bob Dole came to him and explained how the Republicans were going to lose the Senate. And so Reagan reversed courses quietly, but he went out to the Illinois State Fair and announced to all the farmers in central Illinois that he was doing more for the farmers than any other president. And that was the end of that reform, you know. So it's really, I think, like that aircraft, fighter aircraft thing I point out to you in the military. It's like some of the farm programs. There's a lot of programs. The disability programs now are out of control. But these people are desperate because when their unemployment runs out, lots of times they find out they're not feeling too well and they get lawyers to go after the disability. So it's really that kind of program problem that you need constant surveillance on, and then you report to Congress, and sometimes they'll do something, and sometimes you're up against the lobbyists, and you don't always get it. But that's what that's the big problem in government. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
As you said, you're basically as the Secretary of the Navy, you're basically the CFO of the military.
Yeah.
And earlier you mentioned expense cuts that you could possibly make in the military.
Yeah.
My question for you is, what are some of the challenges that you've maybe faced in the past or that you could see now where somebody wants to make a decision but has to deal with a perception thing? Because I know, if somebody wants to put in the papers, this person wants to cut military spending, you know, that might not go over well with a huge group of people. So
right.
how would you deal with that type of situation?
Well, you have to deal with it by getting the issue out in front of everybody. That was what the GAO reports were good at, you know. Go back to that New York City situation. In other words, there was no city or no state, and no large city or no state that had an audit at the end of the year. They all had a budget and then went to the next budget. And a lot of them were getting into problems, as you can see now, on their pension, their liabilities, and things like that. And so anyway, when I made that speech down in Charleston, the controller of Maryland, he decided, by God, I'm going to do it. I'm going to get a AAA bond rating. It means I'll pay less on my bonds and like that. And three or four others followed that, and then we finally got the legislation. But it took us from 75 to 82 to get that legislation through, see. Then on the federal government, it was in 95 when Baker and Darman and everything like this. So every once in a while, then things coalesce that you can get legislation. Just like you get banking legislation when you have a banking crisis. And sometimes it takes a crisis. Leon Panetta, one of my favorites, said, when he first came to government, he always thought all it needed was good leadership, strong leadership. Now he says, give me a big crisis and I'll do better than be trying to be a strong leader, he said. And that's the democracy. In other words, in a democracy, because see, a lot of people think a lot of legislation gets passed, and not a lot of serious legislation really gets passed on guy, because you gotta get it through the committees in the House, the committees in the Senate, you gotta get a reconciliation bill, then you got to get the president to sign it, and then you've got all these special interests that are trying to influence it. So right now, we need tax reform. In other words, we need tax reform on the corporate side and even on the private side. And it's just stalemated. Immigration reform is stalemated. But eventually, we'll get both. Yeah.
Clint?
Perhaps a little different question. In your numerous important positions that you've held, you've undoubtedly encountered pressures to make certain decisions. What advice would you give today's graduating college students on how to withstand these pressures when encountered in today's work world?
Well, that's a good question. When I was out at Case Western University 3 years ago, I was surprised when I looked out at the student body, and so many Asians students were out there. And apparently, they had a lot from China. And one of the young Chinese stood up and asked me a similar question. He said, you must have at some times had to take on a tough issue and were somewhat worried by taking on the tough issue. Somebody might take your head off, you know. And I said, that's right. You got to think that through carefully, and you got to do it skillfully. Like after I became Assistant Secretary of the Navy for a few weeks, my staff came to me and said, Mr. Bowsher, this is a report that goes to the Treasury twice a year on the shipbuilding account. And what we show is how much money we still have left in the appropriation for building ships and repairing ships. And we had 1,000 ships, so you can imagine how much activity was going on in a lot of shipyards. And over here is how much work is yet to be done. And I said, okay. And then I looked, and at the end, at the bottom, they totaled, both totaled to the same amount. So I said, how can you have all the money allotted and all the work to be yet to be done and come out even, you know? I said, I've been in shipyards. I know that there's cost overruns. It's like building anything, and there's cost underruns, more generally overruns. I said, how do you do that? And, you know, they kind of hemmed and hawed, and finally, one guy said, well, every time we issue the report, it always comes out this way. See? And I said, really? I said, gee, I'm not sure I can sign this report. Well, that got their attention because they said, well, you got to sign it. You got to get the Treasury's waiting for it, you know. So anyway, I said, well, let me think about it. And so I called over to the Treasury and found out that they hardly paid any attention to the report. and then I went down to the office next door, and I had a great deputy, Admiral Eli Rich. He was the deputy controller. He didn't know anything about accounting, but he was a great naval officer. He had 3 Navy Crosses, which is the second highest award next to the Medal of Honor, and he was the only American submarine commander to sink a Japanese battleship from a submarine, because battleships could go 32 knots and submerged submarines could only do 8 knots in the old days. So and what he did, he went in the middle of a big convoy of a Japanese fleet on a rainy, dark night, and he thought that he could hardly see anybody, and he didn't think they could see him, and he was looking for the biggest ship, and when he saw a big ship in front of him, he fired all his torpedoes and then dove, see? He should have got the Medal of Honor. But anyway, I said to Eli, you know, I said, this can't be. And he thought it for a minute. And he says, you're right. It can't equal. So then we put a small task force together to try to get behind how they put the numbers together and everything like that. And of course, we knew that they were plugging it. And you know, in accounting, you don't want to plug numbers. You know, that's a no-no. And so anyway, we finally called back, And we got the team back together, and we said, you know, there's a problem. Why don't we send it over as it is? I won't sign it, but I'll say I'm putting a task force together and to try to find out what are the real numbers, you know. As it turned out, we were $1 billion short. And so, you know, that was a big deal. The Navy did not want to learn that they were at a, and they had to cancel ships and things like that to make up for that. So when you hit that kind of a spot, you've got to make the tough decision. Arthur Anderson was a great firm, and I retired in 1981. Needless to say, I was shocked when it went under in 2001, and it was over the Enron audit, basically. And if you can believe this, Ken Lay worked for me for 3.5 years as a young naval officer at the Pentagon. And then he went on for that great career and built Enron and everything, but he got kind of carried away with his importance and didn't really understand when they were really doing some wrong things, needless to say. But the auditors in the Houston office didn't want to lose the client. It was their biggest client. And in the old days at Arthur Anderson, you'd send a team out from Chicago to check a difficult situation like that. And whatever the Chicago guys, the home office said, that's the way it ruled. Well, they had changed the system, and the local office had jurisdiction. And of course, that's not a good system because the local office, they're thinking about, boy, that's going to hit my pocketbook, you know, if we lose the biggest client and everything like that. Make a long story short, they didn't make the tough decision. They made the tough decision 10 years earlier with Keating in Phoenix, when he was cooking the books at his SNL, and they resigned. And that's what they should have done with Enron, see. So the one thing you got to always keep in mind when you face these big challenges is if you don't address them, things can get much worse when it all explodes. And if you are going to try to address them, you got to do it skillfully. You know, you can't run down the hall and say, hey, I'm smarter than you are. You got a problem here, you know. You got to figure out how to do it skillfully. And you know, when you're dealing with Congress, you got to bring them into to the solution, too. Yeah.
Exactly right.
It's time for an audience question. If you'll bring a microphone to the gentleman, please. If you'll stand up and speak loudly into the mic so everyone can hear your question.
Sure. Can you hear me?
Yep. Yeah.
It seems that the American financial system, the American economic system, has been able to deal relatively efficiently with small and medium-sized financial institutions with respect to insolvency.
Yeah.
What's going on with the large institutions? That's my first question. Have we been able to develop any systematic or institutional ways of dealing with that?
Yeah.
And the second thing is, what's the status of credit default swaps these days?
Okay. Your first question is really good. Because we ended up here with 4 big banks now in this country that really look like European banks. In other words, in Europe, you had what they called a universal bank, and that is they did everything. And so in our country, when we had Glass-Steagall, we had the commercial banks that took your money in as a deposit, loaned it to businesses, loaned it to mortgages, but they didn't do stock underwriting. They didn't do a lot of trading and things like that. They were basically safe, and therefore they were insured by the Federal Deposit Insurance Company, and people that put their money in there. And you know, every once in a while you'd have a small problem like we had with the Continental Illinois Bank, and we bailed that out. But we didn't have a lot of problems. But in 08, 09, my God, these banks were in terrible shape because they had got rid of Glass-Steagall. They were doing everything just like the German banks, and then we found out the German banks were, the Deutsche Bank was in terrible shape. And one of the things that happened in 08, 09 that's been finally reported, it wasn't reported very promptly, but eventually reported, and that is our Federal Reserve not only bailed out our big banks, they bailed out the biggest banks in Europe and through their New York subsidiaries. And one time at the Met Pond Club, I was invited to have breakfast with a lawyer there that was born in Berlin. He's American. He was the son of a surgeon who was in Berlin in the 30s. And so he spoke, he lived there as a young boy, so he spoke perfect German. And he was in our intelligence group in World War II. And then after war, he was on boards in Germany and things like that. So he knows Germans very well. He knows a lot of the political leaders. When they came to Washington, he asked me to join them. And they were all upset about the Deutsche Bank. They said it's not even a German bank anymore. All the big decisions are made in New York and London. Well, there's a lot of truth to what they were saying, because that's the same with us. If you notice, J.P. Morgan's big disaster was in London, that $8 billion problem in the trading area and that. So we have ended up now where the four big banks, and if you put Morgan Stanley and Goldman in there, they have 50% of the deposits of this country. And they have these big active trading floors in New York and London and that. And they're very vulnerable, I think. And so you're right. Dodd-Frank and a lot of our efforts have got, I think, most of the rest of our banking system in quite good shape. Any of us that are working on it, and I'm right now serving on an advisory committee at the FDIC, where we, as part of the Dodd-Frank, they required each big bank to come up with what they have a fancy name for it, but then what they refer to it as the living will. In other words, how would you take down Citibank if you wanted to do to them what you would do for a small or medium-sized bank that got into financial trouble rather than just bail them out. Now, Sheila Blair was the big one that wanted this because she felt bad about, at the FDIC, of having to bail out the big banks and not bail out some of the smaller and medium-sized ones. And they always said, well, you got to save the big banks. And she wasn't so sure. Well, right now, you might have read in the paper that just recently the big banks offered their living wills to the government for review. And they didn't pass muster. And the FDIC was especially critical of them. And the Federal Reserve was not so critical of them. But one of the lawyers who I know quite well, who worked in the private sector and worked on those living wills starting 3 years ago, he said there's really quite a big debate going on because the Federal Reserve doesn't think the living wills will ever be successful on the really big banks. There's so much domino effect on the big banks, so internationally speaking and with all the other things, that we will have to bail them out in the future. The issue you've raised is very... to me, one of the most important and scary things that we are still living with, really. And you can't let the banking system go down. I'm convinced of that. I think if you read Geithner's book, which I actually was reading on the plane coming out here, you'll see what a battle of minds it was in the Obama White House because they took over from the Paulson, Bernanke, Geithner team, Geithner shifted, went to Treasury, Bernanke was still there, and Obama, to his credit, continued to save the banks, but they didn't make the big banks pay any penalty. They didn't make them do, and so the big banks today are bigger than they ever were before the crisis, as I say. They've got all the big broker-dealers as part of the big banks now, just like the German and the French and the British banks. And so the country is very vulnerable if those banks if they get into trouble. And I remember saying one day up in New York to a good friend of mine who was in the government, working with us when we did the S&L crisis, and I said, do you think these big banks can really manage themselves successfully at these size and complexity? And he said, I don't think that most of them can, but Jamie Dimon at J.P. Morgan can. It's the one I have confidence in. Well, 2 years later, of course, he had the big disaster in London. So that took away kind of that confidence. And I saw him recently, And he said, forget what I said about J.P. Morgan, you know.
So there was a second question, too.
Yeah, what was the second question?
Well, credit defaults,
all the derivatives are better controlled now because of some of the things they've done, but they're still, I think, a very scary part of the whole derivative area is still there. Brooksy Bourne, who was head of the CFTC, she was the one that the boys over at Treasury, Larry Sumner, Rubin, everybody, and Greenspan, they squashed her when she said that they were a very risky thing. And I had said 2 years earlier in a report that this was very risky, this whole area, because a lot of them were being used to leverage up the financial institutions and then finance that with short-term financing. So I think the derivatives and the four big banks, they're to me the most scary part of our private sector as far as impact on future. Our country works well, but every once in a while, you can't let it happen. You get yourself in a situation like you did in 29 and 32, and then again in 08 and 09, and if they made the wrong decision, we could be completely down and out. And I was in Berlin in October of 09, and that was after the Lehman Brothers had been allowed to go down. I thought the European banking system was heading down the tubes. So we came very close in 08 and 09, and I don't think we solved two or three of the big parts, and you had named two of them. Yeah.
Another question from the audience. Anybody over here?
Hello. We hear every now and then that Russia and China and some people in Europe are trying to establish world reserve currency, like a basket of currencies, as alternative to the dollar. What do you think their chance of success, and God forbid if they did, how that would, you think, will affect us? And another part of the question, do you think what's going on in the Middle East now has something to do with it? Excuse my accent.
I'm trying to catch you guys. Are you saying that China and Russia want to have one of their currencies be a currency like the dollar? Or are you saying they want to have a new thing like an IMF, their IMF, you might say, where they create a new currency?
They have been trying, you know, we read it all over the place. I mean, some countries in Europe also might be, I mean, yeah. In the same...
You know, when the euro was going very well and successful, a lot of people thought it would become a competitor to the dollar. Mm-hmm. Then they got into all their problems here in 08 and 09, and nobody even talks about that anymore. The Chinese very much would like to have their currency become a currency like the dollar that the rest of the world would trade in and everything like that. I wouldn't be surprised at some point in the future, one other country. I don't think we can assume that the American dollar will always be the only dollar. But I do believe that it's very hard for the other currencies to get enough liquidity and enough systems and enough confidence of the rest of the world. But they do get mad every once in a while at America for just being the one that they have to do business with. Mm-hmm. And then also, when we put these sanctions on, like we've done in Iran, and now we're doing in Russia, that hurts a lot of small merchants in a lot of countries. In other words, it doesn't just, a lot of times, I just wonder sometimes whether it really has as big of an impact as we think it does with the leaders, because they have lots of ways of kind of accommodating and getting going around the sanctions. But the poor merchants in those countries and the small banks in that, they get hurt and they get mad and they get thinking maybe America is just a big bully, financially speaking. And I think more than once maybe we have been. And so that's something I think we have to be a little careful of. Yeah.
Another question? Audience question.
What is the profile of the typical GAO auditor?
Speak into the microphone a little closer, yeah. Please.
What is the profile of typical GAO auditor? Were all of them accounting majors in college? Do recent college graduates become GAO auditors, or must they have auditing accounting experience in order to be GAO auditor?
Didn't quite get the question.
No.
Okay. The type of experience an auditor has.
Oh. At GAO? Oh. We had a very diverse workforce because we had maybe 20-25% were accounting majors, CPAs, and that. And they did the financial audits. And, of course, a lot of the other things need a financial review, too, when we're looking at the cost of healthcare and things like that. But then we had healthcare specialists. We had major weapons. And so I had West Point graduates. I had one of my best persons was a concert pianist. She had, you know, a concert pianist has to practice, has to really work hard to make a living as a concert pianist. And she was over in Europe after World War II with her husband, who was an artist, trying to make a living in Paris. And finally, they decided that they had to come back to the United States. And for a couple of years, she got doing program evaluation and audits for NATO in Paris. That's when NATO was still in Paris. And then she came back to and went with the MITRE Corporation. My predecessor hired her. But she was terrific. And one time, we did a very highly secret report on all our nuclear weapons. And she was really the one in charge. Now, she had engineers and people under her, but she was really good. So I often said that I was always kind of impressed by the variety of background and majors in college that was in the GAO, and it was a good mix. And lots of times, too, they'd move from one area to another. And we did that even at Arthur Anderson, too. You know, in other words, like I moved out of auditing halfway through my career into the consulting part, and lots of times I'd be working on banks, and then I'd be over working on something in merchandising or manufacturing, things like that. So I think that one of the things for any professional person, whether you work for the GAO or the McKinsey Company or the Pricewaterhouse, is you want to broaden yourself out just as much as possible as the years go on. And by getting various assignments, you generally have the opportunity to do that. And a lot of times, you really got to study hard and learn fast on a new assignment that you haven't quite been expert in before.
That's great. Yeah. Got a question right up here.
Yeah.
Thank you. Typically, financial and economic things run cyclically in cycles, in other words.
Yeah.
And do you foresee in the near future an upturn in the interest rates? Because I work for our county, and I never thought in my life that Jeff could see millions of dollars and you earn. We were at one time earning over $1 million in interest, and now it probably is below $300,000.
Yeah. Well, every retired person, including my in-laws, would like to know the answer to that question because they're tired of seeing their life savings. Like when my mother and my dad was born in 1900, and when he retired, it was 1965, of course, and they had $100,000 of savings. He was a railroad engineer. And they got $14,000 in interest. That's when the interest spiked there, you know, in the late 70s, early 80s. I have a twin brother, and now he gets about $2,000 on even a government bond, you know.
So this is a real problem for the retired people who are living on a fixed income and that. And I do believe that it will go up here because when you have to sell as many bonds as the American public is selling and the corporations are selling. But the fascinating thing is that the rest of the world keeps getting into trouble. The Middle East, there's a lot of money in the Middle East. Where would you put your money if you were one of those rich oil guys in the Middle East? Well, you're putting it in Europe or in America, and Europe's paying less than we are. So a lot of them are they think of us as even better security or better safety. And so we can sell 10-year bonds for 2.5%. And I have thought for a couple of years, and I think most of the people in the bond world, like PIMCO and that, they've all been assuming it would go up before now. At some point, it's got to go up. But just when, nobody really knows.
I definitely understand that. But that also leads to the second part of my question is that the interest rates being as low as they are in the normal banking and treasury as it is forcing cities, counties, et cetera, with their reserve monies to seek bonds or stock market or brokerage firms in order to increase their interest earning ability. To me, typically has not been something that government ventured into.
Yeah, no, you've got a very good point there because this is a really big problem for governments. And also, if you have a corporation and you have a defined benefit plan, it's also tough for you. And it's going to be more tough for the insurance companies. They're just beginning to come out and saying how tough it is for them to pay off on all these annuities that they have sold and that. I had Jack Bogle as a speaker at the Metropolitan Club here recently. He thinks there's a big scandal coming in this country, in this pension area, for the very reason that all the numbers have been calculated at a much bigger return than what they're getting. And the period of this low interest rate is lasting so long that this could be potentially a big problem in our country. Yeah.
Thank you.
Final two questions from our student panelists. Kristen, if you have one.
Yeah. I do. I know every year government institutions or programs, they have a budget. And at the end of the year, they either exceed or come up short, have extra money. I know, not from personal experience, but from interactions with other people who work with government programs, they say at the end of the year, it's like spend, 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 so that next year they're awarded the same budget.
Yeah.
Is there something in place to knock that out, or how do you address that?
Well, I wish I could say yes, but the answer is no. Unfortunately, that's a terrible system, and you just described it well. In other words, there's this big spending spree at the end. And see, what you got to understand is in the various appropriations, you have what's known as annual appropriations. That's like money for payroll, for operating funds, and things like that. Then you got three-year money, like our aircraft money was generally, no, our research money was three-year money at the Navy. And then we had five-year money for airplanes and 10-year money for ships. But it's really in that operating, the annual stuff, and then even on the other ones, when they're getting the end of 3 years or end of 5 years, you know, everybody rushes to, and sometimes they don't make the best decisions when they're doing that. You're exactly right. There was some efforts made in the last 20 years that didn't come to any fruition to try to get on top of that.
Do you know what percentage of the budget that is?
It could be as high as 5 to 10%. Yeah, it's not a small amount. No, it isn't.
Mikhail, final question.
Just for myself and some of the students here in the audience, could you talk about some of your experiences while in college or in your younger days, that leadership experience or any other kind of experiences that kind of helped you in your professional life and later in life?
Yeah.
Could you elaborate?
Sure. Think about it this way. I was born in Elkhart, Indiana. How many know where Elkhart is? It's a little bigger than Cleveland, but it's not a big town. And I was born in the Great Depression, May 30, 1931. And my mother went to see her doctor a couple of days before she was due, and he said he thought he heard a second heartbeat. And guess what? There was a twin brother in there. And so anyway, the twins were born. Mom developed a blood clot, and in those days, all you could do was pack it with ice, and your chance of saving that person was maybe a third. And so as my dad often said, you know, he had twins, and he had a wife that he wasn't sure he was going to have, and maybe no mother. And then he got laid off 3 weeks later. No unemployment insurance in those days and everything like that. So Jack and I celebrated our first and second birthday up in Canada, because my mother was from Canada when the family had to split up and like that. So needless to say, as we were growing up, we were frugal, because the people that lived through the Depression, I don't know about your like that, but anybody lived through that Great Depression in the 30s, you wanted money in the bank. You wanted some savings, and you didn't spend a lot. And, of course, the cost of living was very small. I remember when we were 10 years old, we got a dime for our allowance, and that allowed us to go down to the Buckland Theater on Main Street and see two major features, the Tele News, the cartoon, and the serial. And then all of a sudden, the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor, and there was a big announcement on the screen. There was now going to be a penny tax on the theater tickets. Walking home, we all just worried that would our parents give us that extra penny, because we had to see the 8th and the 9th and the 10th installment of the serial, see, because generally they were falling through the trap door as we left the movie house. And so, needless to say, our parents quickly gave us the extra penny to make sure we knew what we were on Saturdays and that. But this was the times, and I was in Paul Volcker's office right after Obama got elected, and you probably don't ever remember this, but he went to Elkhart, Indiana within the second week, I think, of being in the White House because it had 17% unemployment. This was now in 2009. And I said to Paul, you don't realize, but you're having coffee here with a guy from Elkhart, Indiana. And I said, I got 17%. And I said, I remember when it was 25 and 30% as a kid and that. So I came out of a very ordinary, my dad was a blue-collar worker and everything like that, but I went to University of Illinois, I majored in accounting, I had a slow start because I had to go in the Army and do 2 years, and I couldn't pass the officer physical, so I was a private. And then I got a master's degree at the University of Chicago, and I went for Arthur Anderson. And that was a great opportunity, because Arthur Anderson was a great firm, and you went out and you did work on all different kinds of clients, and if you could do the work successfully, why you got promoted fast. And so anyway, I had 10 years of experience before I made partner there, and I also got to work on some very big companies, $100 million companies. There was a slight embezzlement up at the Catholic Archdiocese. I was one of the ones sent up there and dealt with that situation and met the cardinal and all that. So I learned to deal with senior people and everything like that. And then I kind of was known as the Catholic expert, even though I wasn't a Catholic in the firm. And Catholic University is in Washington, D.C., and there was a business leader in Chicago who got on the board, and he was shocked that they didn't have an audit. So he was advocating that they have an audit, and his firm, Arthur Anderson, would go out there. So I went out there, and I met an old friend from the Army who is now the Assistant Secretary of the Army. And he said, well, Charlie, this is a great job. And he had been the budget director under Mayor Lindsay in New York. That's how he got to be the Army. And he said, I just put your name in for the Treasury Assistant Secretary of the Navy. And I said, geez, don't do that. I said, just made partner. I said, let's not rock the boat. But then I had to come back a week later to meet the Archbishop there. And we had dinner again, and he said, I got you an appointment for breakfast tomorrow morning with the Secretary of Navy. You can't turn that down. Just go meet him. And he'd just like to meet you. I told him, what's your background? So I did. And at the end of 2.5 hours, he offered me the job of Assistant Secretary of the Navy for Financial Management. And the thing that went through my mind, that's the job that Franklin Roosevelt and Teddy Roosevelt had, and I accepted on the spot.
There you go.
And then, you know, I got terrific experience because now I was dealing with billions of dollars, not 100 million, billions of dollars of the Congress, of the leaders of Boeing and Lockheed and everything like that, see. So it's just what you got to do is you got to get out there and you got to get good experience. That's one advice to anybody coming out of school. Go with an organization that will give you good experience, good training, and then when you get opportunities, you just got to try to have good judgment as which are the good ones and which are the not so good ones. And that's all I did in life. Now, I had a very good friend in grade school when I came up to Chicago. Jack and I were pretty good basketball players because we came out of Indiana, and they had an annual game between the 7th grade and the 8th grade, which the 8th grade always won. But Jack and I beat the 8th grade that year, so the 8th grade took notice of us. And then there was a good basketball player in the 8th grade. His name was Keith Kelly. And later in high school, in a very big high school in Chicago, 2,000 students, we were the two forwards, Jack and I, and he was the point guard, and then we were in the same fraternity in Illinois, and he went to medical school, and Jack and I went in the Army, and then we graduated with MBAs the same day that Keith got his medical degree. Now, in those days, the medical guys had to go do internships and residency, and they didn't get paid much. I remember Mr. Kelly saying to my father, I understand the twins are going to work. Congratulations, he said. My boys are not quite getting a big salary yet. But anyway, Keith got great training. He went out to King County. He went to got in the Air Force and did surgery in England and everything like that. And then he went with the Mayo Clinic when he was in his early 30s. And in 45, they made him chief of surgery at the Mayo Clinic. And that is the epitome of being a top surgeon in this country, in the world. And when I look back, we've stayed in touch even to this day. But he got good experience in the medical area. I got good experience in the accounting area. And that's what, and then you get opportunities and you get breaks. And you got to have a lucky break or two to have a career like I've had. Don't kid yourself. You know?
One great memory from your days at Champaign-Urbana when you were in college. Yeah. One great memory.
One great memory. Well, it was a great 4 years. I joined Pi Ka, and it was a great fraternity, and I was president of the house at the end, and we just had a wonderful time in those 4 years.
I want to show everybody this picture of this really young guy. See that young guy right there? 25 years ago, I wrote this article about you.
That's right, you did.
You remember this.
I do.
25 years old. Look at that young guy there.
Yeah, it does.
We wanted to close tonight with that.
He was good looking, you know? Okay. Thank you. Yeah.
Chuck, if you would join me here at the podium, please. We really appreciate your coming down to Delta State and being with us this evening. And Chuck's also going to be with 3 or 4 of our classes tomorrow morning. He's meeting with the leadership class on campus, and he's meeting with the honor students tomorrow morning. So he has a full slate. We have created with the Colloquia a Delta State University Colloquia medal. And it's my pleasure and privilege to drape you with our special speaker medal. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
And thank you for being with us.
Yeah.
You bet.
Yeah. It's been a great pleasure. I really enjoyed it.
Thank you to our special panel.
Thank you very much.
Please join us for a reception in the foyer.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.